I'm afraid you're going to find much of what I have to say rather obvious, especially since there are so many people here who have more experience in Russian-Norwegian cooperation than I have. Nevertheless, it's based on experience, my own experience and observation, and I hope it may contain some gentle reminders. Can I have the first slide, please? Well, in contexts like this, it's common to talk about opportunities and challenges. Opportunities should always come first in our mindset. And when I put a question mark, it's not because I question the opportunities that exist in cooperation here in the north and between northern Russia, but to indicate that the opportunities are really only limited by our own imaginations. Opportunities are limited, it's up to us to see them and to seize them. At the same time, it's important to acknowledge that there are challenges in the form of differences. I don't believe for a minute that we're different as people, as human beings, but there are real differences in traditions, in legislation, in culture, in institutional framework, and so on. And we have to do some homework to be successful in these conditions. Next slide, please. Now, we tend to think of people in terms of stereotypes. Of people from other nations, but I think also of our countrymen very often. Yeah, that's not the point here. The point is that we need to get past those stereotypes, keep an open mind, and get to know each other. At the bottom of every successful cooperative relationship is good human relations, good personal relations. Next slide, please. Now, if I were to ask you who is the most famous Norwegian in Russia, you might have thought it's Fridtjof Nansen, you might have thought it's Gro Heyerdahl, but it's not. It's this man. And if you do business in Russia, that's a useful thing to know. Actually, last year, one of the major Russian newspapers ran a news story where the message was that Gro Heyerdahl was to marry the other Russian biathlonist Vaya Gondracheva and settled in Russia. And it was the last part, and they didn't realize it was April Fool. But that shows you to what extent it's become part of the Russian framework of reference. Now in Norway, we often talk about football. If you want to do business or cooperate in Russia, you should also be able to talk about ice hockey and biathlon and on things. Next, please. Now, cultural communication is difficult. And there are many famous examples of failures. Some of them are mythical, but the slogan, there should actually be an "and" in the first quotation there. It went, "Nothing sucks like an Electrolux." Now the story is that Electrolux used this as a slogan in the United States to try to sell their vacuum cleaners, and that it wasn't particularly successful. That's not true, actually. They did use this slogan, but they used it in Britain, and they used it humorously. But still, it goes to show that you have to know what you're doing. Chevrolet Nova. Nova in Spanish means won't move, doesn't go. So maybe it's not so surprising that they didn't sell all that many cars. And there's another example which I think I'll mention, which is actually true, where a pharmaceutical company wanted to sell their painkillers in a country with a low degree of literacy. So they made a comic strip. In the first picture, you saw this man who obviously had a bad headache, arrows radiating from his head in all directions. Then he took the pill in the next picture, and in the third picture, he was all smiles. Problem, of course, was that not everyone reads from the right to the left. From the left to the right, sorry. From the left to the right. Yeah. Okay, next slide, please. So, when in Russia, by all means shake hands, but never shake hands across the threshold. Okay? If you visit someone, by all means bring flowers, but make sure it's an odd number. If you want to give a gift, make sure it's not a knife. I mean, there are many such things that you simply need to know. Next, please. And then there are differences in business culture. I can't get into all of them, but I used to be a middle manager in the Norwegian Ministry of Education and Research. And if I told somebody in my unit to do something, let's say within a week, and then do nothing, I could say to assume that everything was okay. If I ask one of our Russian staff in the embassy in Moscow to do something within a week, and then don't hear anything, it's bad news. I have to investigate. And these are real differences, and they go both ways. So you have to understand that business culture is different. So international cooperation is not simple. It takes an effort, and for you to be willing to make that effort, the project must be important to you. You must really want this to succeed. You must be willing to put in the time and effort and sometimes money that is required. Next, please. Now in the field where I work, cooperation in education and science, there are many success stories. I picked two just by way of illustration. I could have picked others. The figures here aren't entirely up to date, but that's not important. Of course, this conference is also a product, as has been mentioned several times already, of cooperation between the University of Nordland and YMEF, which is very successful. And I would like to especially draw attention to the joint programs. Now, we have difficulty in getting Norwegian students to come to Russia for a number of reasons, but the joint programs are a good way. They're also a good form and sustainable form of cooperation because both sides have to put in so much effort that they would then want this to continue so that the effort is not in vain. And actually, there are several Norwegian universities now that are trying the same model. Next, please. So, what did they do? How did they succeed? I know a little about this relationship. Of course, the people themselves are here and can tell you more about it. You have to identify common interests, and not least, you have to take a long-term view. I think this is very important. Rome wasn't built in one day, neither was Moscow, neither was St. Petersburg, nor Norwegian cities for that matter, and there will always be new difficulties. Don't give up, there will always be new difficulties. The thing is, you know, we Norwegians love hiking in the mountains, and you know how it is when you think that you finally have the peak in sight, there's always another peak behind it. And it's the same in international cooperation. When you think you're finally there, you discover that there's still something else that you have to do. And as an example of long-term relations, I mentioned that we have an almost unbroken diplomatic representation from Norway in Russia since 1785. That goes to illustrate the long-time nature of our relationship. There was actually a small disruption during the Second World War. You have to dedicate people and resources. International cooperation isn't something you can do on the side. The two universities, for instance, that I showed examples of, have people who devote all their time to cooperation with Russia, who know the system, know the rules, know where you can get money, and that's, I think, absolutely necessary. You have to listen and learn, both from your opposite party, but also from other people who've been there before, who blaze the trail. Next please. Now, we had interventions from government representatives, and I think the role of government is to create a good framework for cooperation in the form of agreements, be they bilateral or multilateral, be they at state level or at regional level or at local level. All this is important, and also of course it's useful if the authorities at all levels can put up money, which makes cooperation easier. And especially the Norwegian Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Norway finances a lot of activities in the field of education and research, which shows how important cooperation with Russia is in Norwegian politics generally. Next, please. So, do your own work. That's the golden rule. Beforehand and also after you start it. And I would like to emphasize 2 points under the second heading there. Always reply to messages from the other party. Always. I've seen many cases where this doesn't happen and this creates difficulties. It seems obvious, but not everyone does it. Always deliver on promises. If you said that you're going to do something, then do it. Next, please. Yes. Now, this is an image from a theatrical production. This week, Hokksund Lieteati is performing The Metamorphosis by Franz Kafka in Previstniva. Now, if I ask the Norwegian part of the audience, how many of you have heard about Hokksund Lieteati until this moment? If I ask the Russian part of the audience, how many of you know where Previstniva is? So we have, what we have here is an unknown Norwegian theatre company performing a famous play in an unknown Russian town. It's actually not far from Samara. And what made this happen is enthusiasm. Enthusiasm can take you a long way. So, as I've already said, personal relations is what it all boils down to, but they're not built in one day. You have to be patient, you have to be open-minded, you have to do your homework. Next, please. So, towards the end, just a bit about the Arctic dimension. I already mentioned the long-time nature of our diplomatic relations. We have a long history. We now have the Barents Cooperation. We have they're not called border passes. This isn't actually, what's the correct name? It's, well, you know what I mean. You have these documents that allow people on both sides of the border up north to cross the border without a visa, if they live within a certain distance of the border. We cooperate with fisheries, as has already been mentioned, and I would like to add that what makes this success in regulating the fisheries in the Barents Sea possible is, of course, research. Cooperation in fisheries research goes back more than 50 years. Yes? Nearly finished. We cooperate in nuclear safety, environmental protection, and then many areas of research, mostly connected with the Arctic and with the oceans. Those are the two key words, Arctic and ocean. All those disciplines that I mentioned there, and then the others. Indigenous peoples, and then of course we have Svalbard as a unique platform for carrying out science and for doing science cooperation. And the final slide, please. This may surprise you. As I said, we have good support schemes, but when you look at the applications that we actually get to the funds that are specifically dedicated towards Norwegian-Russian cooperation, they are not always all that impressive. In some programs, we actually have difficulties finding enough good projects. So this is another area where it's necessary to go back and do your homework. People have good ideas, but they need to be developed. Thank you very much.